الحمد لله، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وكفى والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم والله غفور رحيم. So my dear and respected brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. So yesterday, Alhamdulillah, we completed Surah Al-Imran. So today, inshallah, from the very first rakah of Salat Tarawih, we'll start Surah An-Nisa. So few ayahs that I would like to talk about tonight from Surah Al-Imran are as follows. Number one, the most important, the single most important ayah of Quran in terms of following our Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or how important it is to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that is explained by this ayah of Quran in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهُ. O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, inform the people that إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهُ, if you wish or if you desire or if you love to see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is loving you, then يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. So what you need to do is that you need to fattabi'uni, you have to follow me. When you will follow me, meaning Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love you. And when Allah will love somebody, the first thing that Allah does is that Allah forgives that person's sins. So before Allah loves you, Allah first makes sure that he has forgiven all of your sins. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you. So we need to prove to Allah that Allah, we want you to love me. And then, you know, we need to be sincere with it. You know, my dear brothers and sisters, the whole world is in a dilemma. You know, if you understand this ayah, you will understand many things about Islam. The whole world is in a dilemma. And that is that people who do not believe in any religion, they assume that they love God, or they assume that God loves them. So you see that a person is open sinner. A person is doing shirk or kufr or acts of fisk, open. But on the bumper sticker, for example, he will put that God loves me or I love God. Or he says that Jesus loves me or I love Jesus, whatever the case is. And in many of the sects within Muslims, there are people who assume that, you know, God loves them because they are doing certain acts. Now those acts are contrary to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But they are assuming that they love Allah and Allah loves them. You see, I remember an incident in India that one of my uncle, rahimahullah, may Allah forgive him. Since most of you right now, I can see sitting out from India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, so you can understand this very well. That he was sajada nashin of a dargah. So it was urs time. I also went there. I was a kid. We used to go there for mithai, you know, tabarukat. So I still remember that when Maghrib time came, I went to the masjid, because that's what we were taught, that, you know, Maghrib Salah, go to the masjid. So what I still remember very clearly is that I saw that in the masjid there was Imam Sahab, Muazzin Sahab and 2-3 other people, that's it. But the dargah was full of people, overflowing with people. People who are doing sajda to the grave, people who are kissing the grave, people were doing all kind of un-Islamic things. And then if you ask them, they say that, well, they love Rasulullah and Rasulullah loves them. And if Rasulullah loves somebody, then Allah loves that person. So in other words, they were saying that Allah loves me. And I understood this when I grew up. You know, when you study Quran, Hadith, then you come to know who are the people whom Allah is going to love. So there are millions of people out there who are doing completely un-Islamic things against Quran and Hadith. Still they are assuming and they are believing that they love Allah and Allah loves them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His infinite mercy gave us a criteria. Criteria to judge. Allah said, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ. Again I will translate it for you. O Muhammad has informed the people, إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ. If you really love Allah, if you really love Allah, then فَاتَّبِعُونِي. Then follow me. اتباع of Rasulullah sallam. When you will follow Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah will instantly start loving you. Yuhibbukumullah. The moment you say that, you know what, I'm going to start following Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will start loving you. And brothers and sisters, if Allah loves you, you do not need anybody. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, is loving you. Who else do you want? And Allah is saying that when I love somebody, the first thing that I do is وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not love you with all the burden of sin in your book of deeds. Allah is saying the first thing that I do is that I will forgive all of your sins and then I will start loving you. And Allah is saying وَاللَّهُ غَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who loves to forgive and He is merciful, the most merciful. So my dear brother and sister, in the following of Rasulullah sallam, there are all benefits. There is no loss in following Rasulullah sallam. There's benefit of this world and there's the benefit of the life hereafter. The benefit of this world is that in this world, Allah will love you. Brother, are you paying attention how important this ayah is? Allah will love you. In this world, before you die, Allah is loving you. And in this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to forgive your sins. So you are alive and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is loving you. You are alive and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already forgiven your sins. Brother, what else do we need? All we need to do is that we need to make a firm pledge that we are going to follow none but Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's it. The moment you start doing ittiba' Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will start loving you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you. That's therefore, brothers and sisters, this ayah is such a shining ayah of the Holy Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding us to follow Rasulullah and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is informing us the reward that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to give us in this world and in the life hereafter. Furthermore, in one ayah which we are going to recite inshallah tonight in Surah Nisa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said regarding falling of Rasulullah. And this also, brothers, you know, as I told you earlier, the problem with you and me is that we are reading and listening to Quran since our childhood. But we do not understand what is being read. It's such a big dilemma. You know, you have become old. You know, like in Urdu say, na muh mein daad, na pet mein aath. You know, people are getting old. But you ask them, what does this ayah mean? They have been reading it. They must have read this hundreds of times, thousands of times in their life. You ask them, that uncle, what does this ayah mean? Beta, humko nahi malum. I do not know. Why? This is the book of Allah. It is addressed to you. How come you say, I do not know? If I sing to you a song of a film, you can easily identify that this film was made on this in this year, and this is the singer is this, and the poet who wrote this song is this. Everybody knows it. If I can sing you a song that was written 40 years ago, 50 years ago, you know, you start singing with me, and you enjoy that. But Rasulullah in one hadith said that the real music, he said, Taghanni. The real music is in doing the tilawat of Quran in a beautiful manner. For Muslim, that is the real music to ears. Which sound could be more beautiful than the sound that comes out from the mouth of a beautiful qari of Quran. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, مَنْ يُتِعِ الرَّسُولِ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. Allah said that a person who follows Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in fact, he is following Allah. Look at this. مَنْ يُتِعِ الرَّسُولِ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. A person who is following Rasulullah, in fact, he is following Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my dear brothers and sisters, this is how important it is. Because when we are following Rasulullah, you are following Allah. And the reason for that is that Rasulullah doesn't do anything by his own choice. Allah said, In huwa illa wahyun yuha. Rasulullah acts, Rasulullah talks based on the commandments from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my dear brothers and sisters, follow Rasulullah. Don't follow anybody else. Follow Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You will be happy in this world. And my dear brothers and sisters, you will be successful in the life hereafter. So that was one ayah. And in Surah Al-Imran, my dear brothers and sisters, there's one surah which I think all of you know it by heart. And that is, قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ تُؤْتِ الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتَنْزِعُ الْمُلْكَ مِمَّنْ تَشَاءُ وَتُعِزُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتُذِلُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ بِيَدِكَ الْخَيْرِ إِنَّكَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. Which means, O Muhammad inform this to people as well. Allahumma malika al-mulk. That, O Allah, who is the King of Kings. تُؤْتِ الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ. You are the one who can give power and dignity to anyone you wish. And وَتَنْزِعُ الْمُلْكَ مِمَّنْ تَشَاءُ. And you can snatch, you can take away power and dignity from anyone that you wish. And then وَتُعِزُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ and وَتُذِلُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ. You can give honor to the one that you would wish. And you can disgrace anyone that you will wish. And بِيَدِكَ الْخَيْرِ and every good is in your hand. إِنَّكَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. No doubt you have complete power over everything. تُولِجُ اللَّيْلَ Finnahar. You are the one who bring darkness when there is all light. Meaning when the sun sets, darkness comes. Who brings that darkness? It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So tuliju layla fin nahar and wa tuliju nahara fil layl. And when it is pitch dark, it is fajr time, you see that the sun is coming out. When the sun starts coming out, it sheds the light. No matter how dark that night was, when the sun comes, it just sheds all traces of darkness. So, تُولِجُ اللَّيْلَ فِي النَّهَارِ وَتُولِجُ النَّهَارَ فِي اللَّيْلِ. And then, وَتُخْرِجُ الْحَيَّ مِنَ الْمَيِّتِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are the one who brings life to dead. Whether it's a dead piece of earth, or a sperm from which a baby is created. That sperm is dead. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts life in that sperm. And وَتُخْرِجُ الْمَيِّتَ مِنَ الْحَيِّ. And a person is alive, and when you decide, you make that person dead. Although few seconds ago, this person was running around, speaking, laughing, eating. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intended and that person is dead. So وَتُخْرِجُ الْحَيَّ مِنَ الْمَيِّتِ وَتُخْرِجُ الْمَيِّتَ مِنَ الْحَيِّ and وَتَرْزُقُ مَنْ تَشَاءُ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is again, brothers, telling us that Allah is the one. My dear brothers and sisters, nobody. It is Allah who gives you and me rizq. Nobody else. And when Allah intends to give rizq, بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Allah doesn't ask your mashwara, how much you want. Allah gives based on His decision. And His decision is based on hikmat and wisdom. A quick background of this ayah is that the shan and nuzul of this ayah is that at the time of the Battle of Khandaq, Trench, it is the fourth year of Hijrah. Rasulullah heard he got the news that mushrikeen are coming and they are 10,000 in numbers. Rasulullah made mashwara. What should we do? How can we protect Medina? Different people gave different mashwara. Salman Farsi, who was from Iran, he stood up. He said, "Oh Prophet of Allah, back in Iran, what we do is that we dig trench around the city. This way, there's no need to fight. Just dig a trench and just sit back." Rasulullah liked it. Rasulullah said, "Let's do it." But this concept was new to Arab, digging trench, and that also in the middle of the desert. So Rasulullah went with a stick in his hand. He circled. He made a circle around Medina. And then Rasulullah looked at Sahaba. There were 3,000 Sahaba. So 10,000 Mushrikeen were coming, 3,000 Sahaba. So Rasulullah said, "Okay, I'm going to make groups. 10 Sahaba in each group. 10 Sahaba in each group." So then Rasulullah said, "I'm going to give each group 10 feet to dig. And it should be this deep." So Sahaba said, "Yes, O Prophet of Allah, whatever you say, we'll do it." It was hot, and you know, Fatih Makkah had not taken place, because after Fatih Makkah there was money pouring in. This is the fourth year. Fatih Makkah took place in the eighth year. So going was tough, little food, little water, little money. But Iman was strong. Sahaba started digging. And Rasulullah said, "I'm going to dig with you as well." Sahaba said, "Oh Prophet Allah, you said we'll dig." Rasulullah said, "No. When everybody is working, I'll work." So they were digging and digging. And the story is short, but I'll just come to the shan and nuzul of this ayah. They were digging, and a group consisting of 10 Sahaba, while they were digging, they came across a big rock. They tried to break it did not break. Another person came, did not break. Umar came to know, since Umar was a wrestler and he was a very strong man, Umar said, "Okay, give me the hammer." So he took that big hammer and he hit that rock, it did not break, it did not move. So now they went to Rasulullah. They said, "Oh Prophet of Allah, you know, this is this big rock and it's not breaking, and until we break this rock, you know, the trench will not be good." So Rasulullah said, "Okay, let's go." So Rasulullah went to that place. He took the hammer. And then Rasulullah made a certain dua and then he hit the rock. That rock broke a little bit. And when it happened, when it broke, a certain light came out. Light came out and went away. Every Sahabi witnessed that light coming out. So Rasulullah said, "Subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed me the palaces of Rome." Now, in the 3,000 group of Sahaba, there were around 300 munafiqeen as well. So those munafiqeen heard and they smiled. That, you know, they don't have enough to eat or drink and they're dreaming of conquering Rome. Rome means Syria and those countries which were the colonies of Rome. So they just smiled. So Rasulullah saw their smile but did not say anything. Then Rasulullah took the hammer again and hit that rock again. Again, a piece of rock broke and a light came out. And Rasulullah said that this time Allah showed me the palaces of Iran. Munafiqeen heard this, they smiled. Third time Rasulullah hit it, Rasulullah said, "This time Allah showed me the palaces of Yemen." Now, none of the Sahaba doubted it. Although they were poor, without any resources, no asbab, no resources, nothing. But they had complete trust that whatever comes out of the mouth of Rasulullah is haq, it is going to happen. Everything was against the means. But they had complete trust and they said, "Oh Prophet of Allah, if you said this, this is going to happen." After Rasulullah moved away from there and that rock had turned into pieces, so Sahaba were cleaning that area, Munafiqeen came, especially Abdullah ibn Ubay came and started taunting. So he said, "Oh, so your Rasul is telling you this and this, you know, not only al-'ayadu billah that he's crazy, but you guys are crazy as well. You don't have enough to eat or drink. Look at your own clothes. None of you have two pairs of clothes. And you are dreaming of conquering Rome and Fars and Yemen. So at that time, you know, a Sahabi turned and said to Abdullah ibn Ubay and other Munafiqeen that what Rasulullah have promised, it is going to happen. So Abdullah ibn Ubay said something which was very bad, insulting to Rasulullah and insulting to Sahaba. What happened, my dear brothers and sisters, was that whatever Rasulullah promised came true. Everything came true. Within few years of Rasulullah leaving this world, during the Khilafat of Umar, you know, Syria, Fars, meaning Iran, and Yemen, all three countries were Islamic countries. And what happened was that the same people who were taunting Rasulullah and Muslim, they were disgraced. They were disgraced. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this ayah to show to us that the honor and dignity is only in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah gives brothers dignity based on your following of Allah and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Brother, try to understand. You know, do not try to change Quran. Do not try to change Hadith. You will fail in doing that. Do not do this. Quran is haq, Hadith is haq. All you need to do is try to follow it. Try to follow it. Do not try to twist and turn. Allah have said that Allah is going to give izzah and dignity to this ummah when this ummah will start following Allah and Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It will come. The problem, brother, is not in Quran and Hadith. The problem is in you and me. We are not following, or we are following half-heartedly. We are following some part of Quran and we are rejecting the other part of Quran. So Allah is not going to give us dignity and honor in this way. One ayah which we are going to recite tonight is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that قُلْ إِنَّ الْعِزَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا أَيَبْتَغُونَ عِنْدَهُمُ الْعِزَّةَ فَإِنَّ الْعِزَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا. Then why are you trying, now this Allah is asking, why are you trying to find dignity for yourself at other places? Allah says, I have put your dignity and honor in following Quran and Hadith. فَإِنَّ الْعِزَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا. So my dear brothers and sisters, don't pick and choose in Quran and Hadith. Try your best to follow Quran and Hadith. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us dignity and honor. And when I say Quran and Hadith, I do not just mean that you should be praying Salah, Zakat, Hajj and Saum and period. No, brothers. As I mentioned to you earlier, these are ibadat. You have to do it. But the most important thing, my dear brothers and sisters, is that your dealing has to be good. This ummah is not lacking in Salah. If you go anywhere in the world, masjids are overflowing with musallis. But the same musallis do not know how to park their cars. The same musallis cannot put their shoes on the racks. The same musalli, when they go and use the restroom, they leave it untidy. The same musalli, when they are eating, they leave that mess outside. That is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying. That first try to be a disciplined group of people. When you are disciplined, when you follow things the way it should be done, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring honor and dignity. No nation likes a nation that is not disciplined. You know, so I'm not saying that bring Islam, it means that you should just pray Salah and when it comes to other thing, you know, you just leave it. No, that is not Islam. That's exactly what we are doing. We have been doing so far. That Salah, yes, Salah. Zakat, yes, Zakat. Psalm, yes, let's fast. Hajj, let's do it multiple times. But when it comes to dealing, when it comes to our manners, when it comes to discipline, we are way in the bottom of the list of nations. You know, this is why one of the most corrupt countries in the world, countries that top, you know, in corruption, are all Muslim countries. Although the masajid are full. So you take pride that mashallah 1.7 billion, till 5 years that were 1.3 billion, now 1.7 billion. We are taking pride So the number is growing, my dear brothers and sisters, but the zillat and disgrace is continuing. The number is growing, but the disgrace is going down. You know, we are just being disgraced more and more because we are failing to understand what Islam is. You see, what Islam is. For example, our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that when the salah is on, don't run. What does that mean? When salah is on, do not run. Come at your normal speed. The other day I came, brother, at Fajr salah, I'll tell you. And at that time I said to myself, this ummah is never going to prosper till they understand Islam. Fajr time. You know, Sunday morning I was at Mego, before Fajr I was coming from Mego to the masjid. The parking lot is empty. Maybe one car or two cars. Pitch darkness, nobody here. Maybe few people. One brother comes and he was thinking, oh, 3 minutes left for Fajr Salah. He had an SUV and he parked his SUV right in the middle of the road. You know this road? And then he came running to the masjid so that he cannot miss 2 rakat of sunnah. Because sunnah, 2 rakat of sunnah before Fajr are the most important sunnah, yes. But in order to get that, he left his car right in the middle of the road. Brother, this is not what is it. This is the wrong way of understanding Islam. This is the wrong way of understanding Islam. We need to understand what Rasulullah have told us. Rasulullah imatatul adha anit tariq minal iman. Rasulullah said that to clear the path, if there is something that would, if there is an object lying that might cause problem to the people who are walking, Rasulullah said, stop, remove it. Because this is what iman is. Iman is not to put hurdles in the path of people. But if you see something that might hurt a person, remove it. And Rasulullah said that this is iman. So brother, when Quran is talking about bringing Islam in your life and Allah will give you izzat, Islam is not saying that just pray salah and other do some other rituals. Islam is saying that no, bring all the etiquette, the discipline that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to see in Muslims. When we'll have all this, then inshallah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us izzah and dignity. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قُلْ إِنَّ الْعِزَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا. If you will bring this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you izzah. So in these nights of Ramadan, brothers, if we can revive the definition of deen in our mind, and if we can start afresh towards Islam, and if we can try to understand the real meaning of Islam, I think it will be beneficial for you and me and for the rest of the ummah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help me understand this. Subhanallah, bihamdi, subhanakallahu, bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka.